Well, good morning. In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, I welcome you to our service here this morning. This is Palm Sunday. Hosanna. Yes, palms here on the altar rail. And at the end of the service, if you would like to grab one of the palms and take with you as a reminder of this service today, I invite you to do so. I'll take one with me as well. This is a special week in the life of the church, Holy Week, as we refer to it, beginning on Palm Sunday and lasting through Easter Sunday. One other thing I wanted to lift up, there will be an Easter egg hunt at Lavalette United Methodist Church at 11 o'clock next Saturday. So anyone that would like to come and help hunt eggs, Jackson, I know you probably look forward to coming and look. We may put you to work doing something else, but you're welcome to come. Everybody's welcome to come and take part in that. Hope the weather cooperates for all of our activities, particularly the ones out at the park. Friday looks real good as far as our cross-bearing service. I'm excited to be a part of that. I've seen those, not experienced one like that, though, before. So I'm excited about that. Everybody I've talked to says it's a very memorable event experience. Saturday for the egg hunt, Sunday morning for our sunrise service, 6:45. I know that's early. Then go home, get ready for church, come to church, Sunday school, and then go home, take a nap. I think is probably a good thing. Easter Sunday are good for that. But invite you to come and be a part of that as well. So again, Easter Sunday this morning, we'll be reading the passage out of Luke's Gospel, Luke chapter 19, beginning with verse 28, Luke's version of the what we call the triumphant entry into Jerusalem for Jesus. Hear these words again from Luke chapter 19, verse 28. After he had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he had come near Bethphage and Bethany at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it.' So those who were sent departed and found it just as he had told them. And as they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' They said, 'The Lord needs it.' Then they brought it to Jesus. And after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven.' Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, 'Teacher, order your disciples to stop.' He answered, 'I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out.'" Amen. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Are you ready for Easter?
Yes.
There's a lot to do, isn't there?
Yes.
Lot to do to get ready for Easter, whether you're planning a family get-together, a meal to prepare for and shop for, just so many things, extra services for the church, for pastors, things to get ready, things to keep track of, maybe planning a trip for spring break coming up here as well. I remember when I was growing up, spring break meant vacation. That was one of the few times. My dad was a pharmacist in Barbersville, had his own drugstore, and it was hard for him to get away. But spring break, usually the week after Easter, was our time for vacation. He liked to golf, and so we would head down to Myrtle Beach, as a lot of folks did in those days, still do. A lot of golf courses down there. And we would go with some other families so that the men, the foursome, they would go out and play golf every day at a different golf course. And of course, the kids, the parents, moms, we would go to the beach, you know, most of the day and the pool, and then get dressed up in the evening and go out to dinner. But I remember one of the things that my dad would do pretty early in the planning stage was make lists of things that needed to be done, you know, before you pack up. Things you wanted to make sure that he took with him, like his golf clubs and things like that. You didn't want to get down there and forget something like that. So he would make lists. I kind of became a list maker myself. Not as much anymore. When I was younger, when you know, used to make more lists. Now I like, there's a part of my phone that you can make lists, make notes. I put on there my grocery list, you know, and I can add them and keep, as long as my phone doesn't die, I'm all right. Got my lists with me. My calendar is important to me as well, trying to keep things straight, services and extra things and times. You know, some Jennifer will say, now what time is that sunrise service going to be? And I can pull it up on my phone. Oh, I'm kind of glad to have that, and you all probably do that as well. Kind of help us keep things in mind. I always wonder if Jesus was a list maker. Whether he needed to make a list of things that needed to be done. This, particularly this last week for him, this week between Palm Sunday and Easter, a lot of things on his mind, a lot of things going on in his life. And I always wondered, you know, whether he made a list. You know, the scripture doesn't tell us that Jesus wrote anything except when that woman was brought and thrown on the ground in front of him at his feet. It says he reached down and wrote in the dirt there on the ground. But there's no record of what he wrote. Yeah. And as far as we know, there are no other records of anything that Jesus wrote. But I wonder if he had a list of things that he needed to get done before he was crucified, before his time on earth was over. And of course, one of the things that he had to go by was the Old Testament scriptures. Mm-hmm. You see, Jesus was the fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecies. And there was one prophecy in particular that I think is important for us to look at today, and that's from Zechariah 9:9. Where it says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you. Triumphant and victorious is he, humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." Jesus fulfilled that passage of scripture on this triumphant entry into Jerusalem. You see, he had walked most of the way, but that last part of this trip down from the Mount of Olives and entering into Jerusalem, it was important that he ride on a donkey. And this donkey was kept there in Jerusalem. He sent a couple of his disciples ahead to get this donkey that maybe he had prearranged, and the code word was, "The Lord needs it." If that's all they needed to say. So that donkey would be there for Jesus to ride into Jerusalem to fulfill those prophecies. You see, Jesus was the fulfillment of the prophecies. Jesus was also a prophet in his own way, often telling things that were going to happen ahead of time. He warned Peter about what was going to happen to him. He knew that Judas was going to betray him. He knew what was waiting for him in Jerusalem when he got there. Pain, suffering, and death. But all of those were to fulfill the Old Testament prophecies about what would happen. Now they proclaimed as he entered, they shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord." It was important that Jesus make sure that his disciples at least understood who he was as the King. But a different kind of King. You see, many were expecting him to rise as a political king, to throw off the Roman oppression and bring Israel back to a time of power. But that's not why Jesus came. Jesus came to be a humble king, riding on a donkey, one who would give his life, sacrifice his own life to bring salvation. Hosanna means save us now. Yeah. As they were waving their palm branches as Jesus rode along. Save us now. Well, Jesus came to save them, but in a different sort of way. In a way that it would take them a while to understand. It takes a while for us to understand how Jesus can bring salvation by dying on the cross. And yet that was part of God's plan, because the wage of sin is death. And the death of Jesus on the cross gives us the promise of forgiveness, gives us the promise of eternal life. Without Jesus' death on the cross, we can't be forgiven of our sinfulness. And we're all sinners, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And so we need to understand who this Jesus was as the King, who He was as the Savior, that He came to bring salvation by dying on the cross. Not what they were expecting. Maybe not what we're expecting from the Messiah. But now we understand. But His disciples were ready to claim Him as King. Not all were ready, were they? Yeah. The Pharisees, some of the Pharisees that were there listening, said, get your disciples to be quiet. They're causing a problem here. They're causing an uprising. And that would have looked bad, wouldn't it? Mm-hmm. But Jesus said, if the disciples stop shouting, the stones themselves, creation itself, will shout out. Now, I always thought it was interesting that what happens to Jesus. You know, often we're tempted to just ride on this parade, this Hosanna Palm Sunday parade, right into Easter Sunday morning, shouting, Hallelujah, Christ is risen. But think about what happened that week. Think about what happened to Jesus during that week. In between these two days of celebration is a very dark, deep valley that Jesus goes through. A valley that includes pain and rejection and betrayal and denial and even death. We need to follow Jesus through that path, don't we? We need to spend some time in this valley this week before we shout hallelujah on Easter Sunday morning. I hope that you'll come out on Friday to the cross bearing as we once again remember what Jesus did for us. It's often referred to as the Passion of Christ. That the movie was called Passion of Christ. Now, I always wondered, passion, when I hear the term passion, I think of a very emotional feeling that we would have, something that we're passionate about as we think of a passion. A passion is something that motivates us, that moves us in the directions that we go. Some people are passionate about music. Some people are passionate about art or teaching or service, things that motivate us, that give us the motivation to do the things that we do. Jesus was passionate about obedience. Yes. Jesus was extremely passionate. He lived His life to be obedient to the Father, to the will of God in His life. And as I think about what happened to Jesus, that was about obedience. Mm-hmm. Obedience is why He was on the cross. Obedience is why He suffered and died so that He could be raised again from death. That Jesus was all about being obedient to the Father. That was His passion. And that passion drove Him to being crucified on the cross. And so as we think about our own passions, the things that we do, are we passionate about being obedient to Christ? About serving Christ? I pray that we are. On Ash Wednesday, when we had our Ash Wednesday service, I talked a little bit about what Lent is all about. Mm-hmm. And Lent is a time of reflection, of repentance, and seeking forgiveness for our sinfulness, and looking into ourselves, a time of self-reflection, a spring cleaning for the soul, if you will. a time when we look into our souls for those things that are keeping us from serving God the way we should serve Him, and things that are in our lives that are keeping us from loving others the way God wants us to love. I liken it to cleaning out your refrigerator. When's the last time you dug deep into your refrigerator down there in those drawers or back in the back, or those things that fall down in the back there? Those are scary sometimes, aren't they? When you go, or you find one of those Tupperware bowls that you don't even remember what's in it, you're scared. Sometimes you're best to just throw that whole thing away. Although maybe you want to save the bowl, don't you think? God, that's what Lent is kind of like in our souls. It's a time for us to do some self-reflection, to look for those things in our lives that we've kept secret, that we've kept hidden from God. Well, you can't keep anything hidden from God, can you? But we've tried to keep hidden. And this is a time when we have tried to search out those things in our lives that we need to clean out. Things that are getting in the way of serving God, of loving God, of serving Him and loving others the way He wants us to do that. You've only got a few more days of Lent before we get to Easter. So I pray that you will spend some time this week continuing to do some self-serving, some self-searching in your own lives, as well as you think about the sacrifice that Christ made for you. As we think about that dark, deep valley that Jesus had to go through and how He was preparing for what was going to happen, knowing the pain and the suffering and the sorrow and the pain of rejection, the pain of denial, the pain of betrayal that He would go through, the things that He did and endured for us. But think about also what you're willing to sacrifice for Him, what things that you're willing to give up in your own lives so that you can serve Him better. And then come back again next week and we will shout hallelujah. Amen. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Let us pray. Our gracious God, we are thankful for this day. We are thankful for the day when Jesus helps us to understand that He is a king, but a different kind of king, a different kind of kingdom, a kingdom of those who will believe in Him as the Son of God, who will believe in Him as the suffering servant on the cross, that He died for our sins but rose again. So, Lord, help us this coming week to remember the sacrifice, to spend some time in this valley with Jesus, remembering what He went through for us, so that we can think about what we can do for Him, how we can serve Him, and clean out those things in our lives that are getting in the way. Gracious God, we are thankful for the invitation that You have made to be Your disciple. Pour out Your Spirit upon us and help us to be the disciple that You would have us to be. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Can we come up with a closing hymn?
301 in the Methodist hymnal.
301 in the Methodist hymnal. And again, as you make your way out to Sunday school, or if you want to come up and get a palm branch to take with you, I invite you to do so at the end of our service. Let us stand as we sing together, number 301, Jesus, Keep Me Near the Cross. gracious God, keep us near the cross. Help us this week as we seek to spend some time in the valley with Jesus so that we will better understand the glory of the resurrection. Lord, pour out your Spirit upon us. Be with us this week. Be with us always. Guide and direct us in all that we do as we seek to serve you in the power of Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. Amen. Go in peace.